Mr. Simpson is again present before the court with counsel. Mr. Bailey, are you standing to address the court?
I have a matter, Your Honor.
And what is that, sir?
Did you have in mind any time to argue the matter of the witness we've been discussing in chambers?
Refresh my recollection.
The lady out...
Yes. I had thought that matter was taken off calendar. That was the impression I was left with the last time we talked.
I think the last time we... What's that?
I checked yesterday and I was told it had not been back on calendar.
You want to litigate that issue?
I would like to argue the issue at some point because we are trying to arrange a date a week hence for its accomplishment, if granted.
Okay, why don't we chat at the next break?
All right, fine. I just wanted to bring that to Your Honor's attention.
All right, I guess that was sufficiently cryptic. All right, anything else before we invite the jurors to rejoin us? All right, Deputy Magnolia, let's have the jury, please.
Courtyard where you had the dog, you and your wife were with the dog, and then Bettina came out of the apartment.
Yes, that's correct.
And you said that was about 11:40?
Approximately 11:40, yes.
And you said that you explained to him what had happened with the dog that night?
Yes, I told him briefly the events leading up to that particular point in the evening and my desire not to bring the dog to the animal shelter and my concern about bringing it into my apartment.
Did you tell him where you'd found the dog?
Yeah, yes. He lives in the neighborhood too, so I told him approximately where I had first found the dog.
So did you have a discussion with him about what to do with the dog then?
Yes, we had a brief discussion in which I explained that why I didn't want the dog to go to the animal shelter where they would lock it in a cage overnight, and he offered to take the dog for the night.
And did he take the dog?
Yes, he took the dog, and we agreed that I would get it back from him in the morning so that I could then put up posters for, saying that there's a lost dog, maybe take a picture of the dog and post that in the neighborhood so that we could find the owner. So we agreed that I would get it back, I would give him the dog overnight, and I would get it back from him before he left for work in the morning.
During the time that you were walking your own dog, do you recall seeing a man and a woman walking together at some point on your route?
Yes, that particular night I didn't run into too many people. If I ran into these two people, if I could show you.
Please.
Yes. As I was walking here along Gorham, I passed a couple coming from the other direction, a man and a woman. I don't know what their relationship was, but I passed these two people, and the woman saw my dog, who was very cute, and bent down to pet it. I spoke briefly to them, people asking, how old is your dog, what's her name, that kind of thing. And she petted my dog, and then they continued in this direction on Gorham, and I continued to go in the other direction towards Amherst.
Could you tell if that couple was young or old?
They were youngish. I couldn't tell you their exact ages, but they seem younger than me. So it's like in their 20s or so.
And could you describe them at all?
It'd be very difficult for me to if I met them today, I doubt I would be able to say these are the two people who I saw that night. I saw them very briefly and at night.
Okay.
So it would be very difficult for me.
Could you tell how tall they were? Were they very large people, medium-sized, small people?
About average. The woman may have been blonde, but I'm not positive because it was night.
Okay. She's Caucasian?
Yes, so they were both Caucasian, if that's a help.
Okay.
And I believe the man was dark-haired as opposed to the woman who I thought was blondish.
And did you see that couple again later on?
Yeah, that was the strange thing. Right after I had walked down Gorham to Amherst and then come around up Dorothy and encountered the dog here and walked with the dog. And as I said, I crossed back to the west side of Bundy here. As I was walking along here with the two dogs, I encountered that same couple coming the other direction. And the woman said to me, "Oh, now you have two dogs." And I said, "Yes, but one's just a friend of the family." And they continued on, and I continued on, and that was the last time I saw them.
And were they walking southbound on Bundy at that time?
Yes, they were walking in this direction. So I was passing them as I was coming this way and as they were going south. Yes.
Do you recall giving the police a statement in the early morning hours of June the 13th?
Yes.
Do you recall approximately what time it was when you gave that statement?
It was approximately 5 a.m. I remember hearing the pounding on the door, on my door. My dog started barking. I had no idea what was going on. And I looked at the clock and I remember thinking, my God, it's 5 a.m. Why is someone pounding on my door?
And was it the police?
Yes, when I got to the door, there were two police detectives standing at the door.
And did they ask you some questions about what had happened the night before?
Yes, they said they needed to talk to me in connection with a homicide. The dog was somehow connected with a homicide. I was not even dressed at that point, so I asked them to wait downstairs by that patio area that I spoke about earlier. I went in and got dressed and woke my wife and explained to her what was going on. My wife and I came downstairs, and they were downstairs with Bettina and Sukru, and I sat down with my wife as well, and we spoke to them briefly.
Okay, what was your state of mind at that time?
Well, I was very confused. I was very scared to find out that the dog was somehow connected to a homicide. I said, had no idea the night before that the blood was a person's blood. It was very disturbing to hear that.
And when you did you tell them how you'd found the dog?
Yes, I briefly said that I had found this lost dog the night before while walking my own dog.
Did you tell them your time estimate of when you saw that dog at Dorothy and Bundy?
Well, they had asked me at what time, approximately what time I found the dog, and I was very confused at that point, and I rattled off a couple of different times, but I was not clear as to what time the events had taken place. I wasn't clear what day it was at that point.
And why was that?
Well, as I said, my routine changes based whether it's a weekday or a weeknight, and this happened to be Monday morning. I knew I had I had to work the next day, but I wasn't clear as to whether it was a weekday or a weeknight the night before. So I was having trouble remembering what time I had started my walk on that particular evening. I was not clear at that point as to what day of the week it even was the night before.
Okay. So they had woken you up from sleeping at the time they knocked at your door at 5 a.m.?
Yes, I was soundly asleep before that.
So you were confused?
I was confused and scared. It was very shocking to hear about this, to hear that someone had died, that the people who owned the dog were not here, were not, around.
And so what time was it that you told the police at that time when you were confused and disoriented? What time did you tell the police that you had gone, you had found the dog?
The first time that I mentioned was 11:30, and then I said no, it must have been around 11. I was trying to get a fix on it, vaguely, and as I said, Bettina and Sukru, my wife, were there, and there was a lot of talking and cross talking going on, no, I saw you then, and that kind of stuff. So I wasn't clear, but those were the times that I mentioned initially.
And did it become clear to you upon calmer reflection when you were able to gather your wits at what time it was when you saw the dog?
Yes. I mean, after
I went after this brief interview, I went back to bed, and the next morning and day, I then remembered more clearly what the sequence of events was, and I was disappointed in myself for not being clearer with the police that night.
Okay. And did you make some effort to tell the police that you had made a mistake?
Yes, at that point when I realized that my statement was inaccurate, I called the police on the phone. I was trying 911 and the local police number in Brentwood. I don't remember which number I got through on, but eventually I spoke to someone and explained that I was a witness to the murder that had taken place the night before, and that the police had come by, but I had given them a very inaccurate statement.
And what did they tell you?
They took down my name and number and said that someone would get back to me.
Okay. And did you testify at the preliminary hearing in this matter?
Yes, I did.
And did you testify to the events that you've testified to today before this jury?
Yes.
And to the accurate time that you recalled when you reflected upon it further later in the day?
Yes.
On June 13th?
Yes.
Nothing further.
Mr. Douglas? Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good
afternoon. Mr. Schwab, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Have you had a chance to review any documents prior to testifying today?
When I received my subpoena, I got a copy of my testimony from the preliminary hearing that came with the subpoena. Okay.
And you had a chance to look that over, sir?
I looked it over, yes.
Did you also have a chance to look over the statement that you had given to the officer about which you spoke?
No.
Okay. You've had a couple of meetings with representatives from the district attorney's office?
I was called in yesterday, and I've spoke to Marcia Clark and to Sherry yesterday while I was waiting in the interview room.
Okay. Have you had occasion to speak to anyone else about your testimony from the DA's office?
No.
Now, the interview that you had with the officer occurred what day?
That was June 13th.
And would that have been approximately 5:30 in the morning?
The only time I looked at the clock was when I was first woken up. I looked at the clock on my nightstand, and I don't remember the exact time that it said, but I remember thinking, my God, who could it be? It's 5 a.m.
Sure.
So that's what I recall.
Did you ever have a chance to review a copy of the statement that was taken of your interview?
I was shown the statement at the preliminary hearing briefly.
Do you remember what time the statement said that, or what day the statement said that the interview occurred?
No.
Can I just show him something, Your Honor? Yes. I wanted to show you a document and ask you to look it over and to read it to yourself. Is that a one-page statement concerning the interview that you gave?
It's a one-page statement. I don't know when it was written or what it was written based on. I have no way of knowing that.
And what date does it say that the interview actually occurred?
It says 6/17/94.
And that would have been Friday, June 17th, correct?
It says June 17th, but...
And that would be incorrect.
I don't know when this statement was written, so if it's meant to reflect what I said on the 13th, then saying the 17th would be wrong. But I don't know when this was written or in reference to what.
Okay. Did you ever have an interview with a Detective Roberts on June the 17th?
I don't recall meeting a Detective Roberts, and I don't recall talking to anyone on June 17th.
You recall talking to an officer on the 13th?
Two officers.
Do you recall any other names?
No, I did not get their names.
To the extent that this document suggests that your interview was on the 17th, it would be incorrect.
Again, if it's supposed to refer to that interview with the two detectives, then I don't know. Again, I don't know what this is in reference to. So you're asking me to say if it's about that particular event, then it's wrong. I don't know.
Well, the statement is a one-paragraph statement, is it not?
Yes.
And it talks about you walking your dog in the area around Bundy and Dorothy, doesn't it?
Well, first it says Dundee. It doesn't say Bundy. So that could be a spelling error.
Okay.
It's...
And the statement talks about the fact that this dog came up to your dog and started following the both of you, does it not?
There's a sentence to that effect, yes.
And it kept going from house to house, correct?
It mentions the going from house to house.
And that the dog kept following you until you got home, correct?
Yes.
And it says in this statement that you first saw the dog around 11:15, doesn't it?
That's what it says on the statement.
Now, when you were speaking with the officers about this occurrence, you were present with at least one other officer?
Yes, there were two detectives present at on that Monday morning.
And they were both in plain clothes?
That's correct.
And they were speaking with you and your wife as well?
They were speaking to me. My wife was present.
Was there anyone else present?
Bettina and Sukru.
Both of the four of you and these two detectives were standing together talking?
Yes, they were all present.
Was everyone contributing to the conversation when you were talking about your portion of what occurred, or were you the only one talking about the different times that you first saw the dog?
There was much contribution from all of us, and it wasn't just, we were asking questions of the detectives as well because we had no idea what was going on at that point.
Do you recall specifically telling the detective that you saw the dog at 11:15, or do you recall giving some other range?
I recall giving various times and not being clear even at that point of what time it was. I didn't say it happened at this particular moment. That was not what I said.
So you never said that it happened specifically at 11:15?
Correct.
Objection, it's not impeaching.
Overrule.
Did you? What range do you recall giving them of the time frame about which you first saw the dog?
As I said, I mentioned 11:30 at one point. I mentioned 11 o'clock, but always it was around 11. You know, it was around 11:30 or it was around 11 o'clock. Okay. Those were the times that I was going through in my mind.
And was it the next day that you then called back 911 seeking to correct the misinformation that you had given?
I believe it was the next day, yes.
And do you recall the person with whom you spoke the next day?
No, I did not get the name of the officer to whom I spoke.
You told them your name?
Yes, I believe that I did.
Did you give them your address?
I don't recall.
Did you tell them that you had previously given a statement and had given a certain time about having found a dog?
I told them that I was not clear the night before when I had given a statement.
Okay. So you specifically referred it to an earlier interview?
Yes.
Did someone suggest to you that there would be an officer coming back to you trying to clarify the misinformation?
I believe they said something along the lines of, we'll get back to you. So it wasn't clear whether someone would call or someone would come by.
How did they treat you when you called them back trying to correct the earlier statement? Were they rude to you?
No.
Okay. Were they abrupt with you?
No.
Did anyone ever contact you to try to correct the misinformation that you had given earlier?
I didn't speak to anyone prior to getting my subpoena for the preliminary hearing.
Now, you say that as you were walking on your walk with your dog, and by the way, what kind of dog do you have?
My dog is part Corgi and part Sheltie.
And was your dog being walked on a leash?
Yes.
You say that as you were walking down Gorham, you happened to come across two individuals.
That's correct.
And they were walking westbound on Gorham, or were they walking eastbound? And just so that we're clear, the lower left-hand corner would be toward the west.
As you can see, it's not exact, obviously. I mean, the streets don't run perfectly east to west or north to south, but they were coming in this direction, walking towards, in the direction of Bundy, and I was walking in the opposite direction, walking towards Amherst.
So they were walking northeasterly, and you were walking southeasterly?
I'm not clear on what you're...
Okay. On the exhibit that's in front of you that you're looking at, that's exhibit number...
I was walking, if this map is north to south, there's no legend on it saying this is north south running, but...
This is exhibit number 26, correct? For the record.
Yes.
You were walking which way? From left to right or right to left?
I was walking in this direction, down this way.
From the right to the left on exhibit 26. And they were walking the opposite direction?
Yes, they were walking this way.
Now, do you have any recollection of what they were wearing?
No.
Do you have any recollection of whether, for example, the woman was wearing pants or a dress?
No.
Do you have any recollection whether either wore glasses?
I don't recall.
Do you have any recollection whether either was wearing a jacket?
I don't recall.
All that you can recall is that there were two Caucasian individuals.
Yes, and...
And a male and a female.
Yeah, and that they were together. They were walking together.
Was there anything distinctive in the speech patterns of either, such as an accent or anything like that you could discern?
Not that I can recall.
As you were walking towards the up Bundy and walking towards Bundy, I'm sorry, up Dorothy and towards Bundy, you had occasion to notice a dog ahead of you, did you not?
Yes.
What was it about the dog that caused your attention to be drawn to that dog? Was it just seeing the dog first?
At first, I just saw the dog standing there.
Okay. And how far away were you from Bundy when you first noticed the existence of that dog?
Well, as you see on the map, there's this alley here. I was past that, so I was about halfway between the alley and Bundy when I first spied the dog.
So, for example, when you were walking on Dorothy, walking up west of Gretna Green, you didn't notice a dog?
No.
You didn't hear a dog?
No.
You didn't hear any sort of long wail?
Not that I recall.
As you got to Gretna Green, heading toward Bundy, you didn't notice the dog?
I'm sorry?
As you were at Gretna Green, walking up towards Bundy, you didn't notice the dog then?
No.
You didn't hear any sort of wail?
No.
When you were at the actual alleyway, where the alley bisects Dorothy, you didn't see the dog?
Not at that point.
You didn't hear a dog?
No, I first saw the dog.
So your first attention to the dog was seeing it and not hearing it?
That's correct.
When you saw the dog was looking in the walkway of the home that is on the corner of Bundy and Dorothy?
No.
What was the dog doing?
It was just standing at the corner.
Just standing, doing nothing?
Yes.
Did the dog appear to be in any distress when you first saw it?
No, it was just standing there.
When you first saw the dog, did you happen to hear any other dogs in the neighborhood barking?
I don't recall.
Okay. You don't have a present recollection of hearing any other dogs at the moment that you first saw the Akita?
I don't remember hearing any other dogs.
When you saw the dog did not have a leash?
That's correct.
Okay.
When you saw the dog, you walked and approached the dog holding the leash of your own dog.
That's correct.
And you said that there was something going on with your dog smelling the Akita.
Yes.
While your dog was smelling the Akita was not then barking, correct?
I don't recall.
Because the Akita at some point began smelling your dog as well, didn't it?
The Akita did smell my dog.
You've estimated the time that you arrived at Bundy and Dorothy as being 10:55 in the evening.
Approximately.
Were you wearing a watch at that time?
Yes, I was.
Did you have occasion to look at your watch other than the time when you turned on Gretna Green?
No.
How much time would you estimate that you spent standing on the corner with the dog at Bundy and Dorothy?
Approximately a minute or two.
And then you crossed over Bundy to go to the east side of Bundy, is that correct?
That's correct.
As you crossed on the east side of Bundy, you were on the even-numbered side of the street, weren't you?
I don't know.
Okay. You did say something, perhaps I'm mistaken, that when the dog was at the corner of Dorothy and Bundy, the Akita was looking down the walkway of the corner home there. Do you recall saying that?
I recall saying that. Sure.
At what point did you see the dog looking at the walkway of the home on the corner of Dorothy and Bundy?
As I was stopped there with the dog would occasionally turn away from me, look down this path, and start barking and howling at the house on the corner.
Since June the 12th, have you had occasion to walk this area again?
I've walked this path since then.
Do you now have some understanding of the relationship to where the dog was at Bundy and Dorothy and the crime scene at 875 South Bundy?
Well, I've seen a lot of news crews and such in front of the house, so I know approximately where the entrance to the house is.
The home on the corner where the dog was looking at the walkway is a single family residence, isn't it?
I believe that it is.
And next to that residence is a separate apartment or condominium complex, isn't there?
There's a house next door. Right?
And then two houses away from the corner would be the complex where the crime scene was located, correct?
I don't know. I don't think that that's correct.
When you saw the dog on Dorothy and Bundy, you noticed that the dog had an expensive collar.
Yes.
And you wanted to try to see if you could locate the owner of the dog.
That's correct.
Did you happen to see anyone else in the neighborhood at that point walking their dog as well?
No.
After crossing over Bundy, you then began walking northbound on Bundy toward Montana, you've said.
Yes.
And as you were walking northbound on Bundy, that would have been across the street from the crime scene.
That's correct.
And as you were walking northbound on Bundy, you say that the dog happened to stop periodically and start to bark.
That's correct.
The dog wasn't barking continuously as it was walking northbound behind you, was it?
No.
Now, as you saw the dog, you happened to notice that there was something reddish on its hind legs.
I'm sorry, could you say that again?
As you noticed the Akita, you noticed something reddish on the paws of the Akita, the hind legs, didn't you?
Yes.
And you interpreted that reddish substance as being blood.
That's correct.
You never bent over to touch the reddish substance, did you?
I didn't touch it. I did bend over to examine it.
You didn't touch it, but you bent over to examine it.
That's correct.
Did you get any of the reddish substance on your hand or on your body at all?
No, as I said, I didn't touch it.
you couldn't tell by simply looking at the substance how long the substance had been on the dog?
No.
That time of the evening, you said that the traffic on Bundy is pretty light.
Yes.
Did you happen, while you were walking northbound on Bundy, and knowing as you know now where the crime scene was located, did you have occasion to see anyone walking out of the condominium complex directly north of the crime scene to go to the mailbox?
I didn't look in that direction.
While you were walking your dog northbound on Bundy, did you ever see the Akita walking in the street?
The Akita walked with us in the street.
Did the Akita walk in the street or on the sidewalk?
When we crossed the street, the Akita was with us.
And then as you were walking on the sidewalk toward Montana, the Akita was also on the sidewalk?
Except for the times that we were crossing the street, yes.
Okay. You never saw an occasion, for example, when the Akita was standing in the street, in the middle of the street on Bundy, near where the crime scene was?
Not while I was present, no.
Now, you've stated that the loudest and the longest barking of the dog occurred when the dog was at the intersection of Gorham and Bundy. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And what did the dog do? Did the dog just stop and begin barking?
Yes. I was walking with my dog. The police officer was behind the dog, and the dog stopped at that corner and barked for a period of time.
Okay. Now, when you were talking to the police officer, did you happen to say anything to the police officer about having observed blood on the dog?
No.
Did the police officer say anything to you to suggest that the police officer had seen or had noticed blood on the dog?
No.
Your having seen blood on the dog did not trigger in your mind any sense of concern such that you sought to mention that fact to the police officer?
Seeing the blood on the paw, I had thought that the dog possibly had cut itself. I didn't mention it to the police officer, as I recall.
Okay. Now, the police officer that you saw was coming southbound on Bundy when you saw it the first time, true?
I don't recall where the police officer was coming when I first saw him.
Okay. When you first saw the police officer, that was an African-American officer?
That's correct.
Was he by himself or with
a
partner?
He was by himself.
Was he the same police officer that you gave your name to later?
Yes.
You have a particular recollection of returning to your home on Montana at 11:05 approximately, correct?
Approximately 11:05.
And you know that because the Mary Tyler Moore Show that had began at 11 o'clock had just begun.
Correct.
Thank you, sir. No other questions.
Any redirect, Ms. Clark?
Yes, please.
Mr. Schwab, you testified at a preliminary hearing back in July of 1994, didn't you?
Yes.
You recall that?
Yes, I do.
And at that time, you were asked questions very similar to the ones you were asked today, is that right?
Yes.
I'm going to read a couple of questions and answers to you from the transcript of the preliminary hearing and ask you if you remember giving the answers that I'm going to read to you to the questions that I will also read to you. Counsel, page 35, line 15. Question. During the week, what time do you usually walk your dog at night? Answer, I usually leave the house at 11:30. That's during the week. I generally watch the Dick Van Dyke Show and then walk my dog, and during the week that's on between 11 and 11:30. Question, and on Sunday nights? Well, the Dick Van Dyke Show is also on, but it's on an hour earlier. So I watch the Dick Van Dyke Show. On Sunday evening, I watch it between 10 and 10:30, and then I go to walk my dog. Question, now June the 12th was a Sunday, sir? Answer, yes, it was. Question, did you watch the Dick Van Dyke Show that night? Answer, yes, I did. Question, and that was at what time that you watched that show? Answer, I watched that show between 10 and 10:30. Question, did you watch the entire show, sir? Answer, yes, I did. Question, and what time did that show end? Answer, that ends just prior to 10:30. Question, did you walk the dog that night after you watched the show? Answer, yes. As soon as the show was over, I got my dog, put her on leash, and took her for a walk. Question, on the night of June the 12th, that Sunday night, about what time did you leave your apartment to walk your dog? Answer, shortly after 10:30, between 10:30 and 10:35, it was closer to 10:30. Do you recall those questions and your giving those answers?
Yes.
Is that still your testimony today, sir?
Yes, it is.
And that was back in July of 1994?
That's correct.
Counsel, directing counsel's attention to page 37. Eight till 21. Or actually, Question, how long did it take you to get to Gretna Green? Answer, well, I looked at my watch when I turned to go down Gretna Green, and that was 10:37. I remember that my dog had taken care of its business, and I was deciding whether to return home or continue walking. It was a nice night, so I decided to continue walking. Question, so what time was it about when you got to Gretna Green? Answer, 10:37. Question, 10:37, you know that exactly? Answer, well, between 10:35 and 10:40. I was just not exact because I don't have a digital watch, but it was between 10:35 and 10:40. Question, were you wearing a watch at all? Answer, yes, I was wearing a watch. Question, a regular watch, not the digital kind? Answer, not the digital. In fact, I'm wearing it now. It's a regular watch. By the way, are you wearing it now?
Yes. Yes, I am.
First of all, sir, do you recognize those questions and those answers?
Yes, I do.
Were those the answers given in response to the questions I read to you at the preliminary hearing in July of 1994?
Yes.
And that is still your testimony?
Yes.
And on cross-examination, counsel at page 61, line 12. To line 19. Question, now you indicate you got home then about 11:05. Answer, that's correct. Question, had the dog, the Akita dog, stopped barking by that time? Answer, yeah, the dog seemed to have calmed down considerably by that time. It again followed me right up the stairs, right to my front door. Do you recall giving those answers to those questions back in July of 1994 at the preliminary hearing?
Yes, I do.
And that's still your testimony, sir?
Yes.
And again, at the preliminary hearing, did you also describe your state of mind when the officers came to take your testimony on the morning of, at approximately 5 a.m. in the morning of June the 13th?
How about the scorecard?
Sustain. Thank you, counsel. Proceed.
Is that objection overruled, Your Honor?
Proceed.
All right, sir.
Came to your door at approximately 5 a.m. on June the 13th.
Yes.
And you described
your confusion and disorientation at...
Overruled.
At that same time, at the preliminary hearing back in July of 1994?
Yes.
As you have today here, sir?
Yes.
Mr. Schwab, that concludes your testimony for today. I'm going to ask you not to discuss your testimony with anybody else other than the lawyers in the case until the matter is concluded. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
And Ms. Clark, you have a report that is up here on the witness stand. All right, who is the people's next witness?
People call us your Sukru Boztepe.
All right, Mr. Boztepe, would you stand over here just to the side of the court reporter, please, and face the court clerk?
You do solemnly swear that the testimony you may give and the cause now pleading before this court should be the truth, the whole truth, and that the truth shall help you, God?
Yes.
Please have a seat in the witness stand and state and spell your first and last names for the record.
Sukru Boztepe, Sukru Boztepe.
Ms. Clark.
Good afternoon, Mr. Boztepe.
Good afternoon.
Sir, directing your attention to the date of June the 12th, 1994. As of that date, sir, where did you live?
I live in Montana Avenue between San Vicente and Bundy.
Now, directing your attention to the chart that's been marked as People's 26, can you tell us? Go ahead and take a look. See this icon, this house here?
Yes.
Is that approximately where you live?
Yes, it is.
And is that an apartment building, sir?
Yes.
And did you have a neighbor in that apartment building by the name of Stephen Schwab?
Yes.
And you both lived in the same building?
Yes.
Can you tell us, sir, what is the approximate distance from your, from that apartment building on Montana to the location of 875 South Bundy?
Around two blocks or like 700 feet, 600 feet, something like that.
Do you see the location of 875 South Bundy on that chart, sir, People's 26?
Yes.
Can you point it to us, sir? That's the, is that where the east side of the street, is 875 South Bundy on the west or the east side of the street, if you know?
I believe it's west.
So if, let me orient the witness first. If that, if my right is the east and my left is the west.
It's west.
It'd be on the west side?
You so mean this building doesn't belong to this street, correct?
Right. It belongs to Bundy.
Okay, it's this one.
That area
or,
there?
Or this one.
One of those two. Yeah. Okay. For the record, the witness is pointing to either the red or the blue house. Now, did you go out that night at some point, sir?
Yes.
And what time did you come back?
It was 11:40. p.m.
Were you alone?
I was alone.
And you got back to your apartment building at 11:40?
Yes.
When you got back to your apartment building, is there a courtyard that you enter into in order to get to your apartment?
Yes.
Did you see someone you recognized in the courtyard?
Our neighbors, Stephen and Linda Schwab, was there.
And did Stephen, was he alone?
He was with his wife and with a white dog.
Had you ever seen that dog before?
No.
Did you go up and talk to him?
Yes, I did.
And did you discuss the dog?
Yes, with it I asked whose dog it was.
And did he tell you about where he had found the dog?
Yes, he did.
Can you describe what the dog looked like?
It was a big, white, beautiful dog. And that's
now, I'm sorry?
And that's all I can describe.
The area that you were, that you found Steve Schwab in with the dog, is there a pool nearby?
Yes.
Is that the pool area of the apartment building?
Yes.
Showing you a series of photographs that can mark as People's 40. Can you see that?
Yes.
Did the dog look like the dog depicted in People's 40?
Yes.
Now, after you had the conversation with Mr. Schwab about the dog, what did you do?
We decided to keep the dog in overnight. I took the dog out from the alley entrance of the building and then walk around to the building and then come back from the front door.
You did that by yourself?
Yes.
Was your wife anywhere nearby?
She was just in front of our apartment door.
Okay. Was she talking to somebody or was she just standing there?
She was talking to Linda Schwab.
To Linda Schwab?
Yes.
Would that be Steve Schwab's wife?
Yes.
And was that in the courtyard area of the building as well?
Yes.
Okay. So you took the dog out and you walked around the building?
Yes.
Did you remember to say that when you testified at the preliminary hearing, sir?
No.
When did you remember that?
A couple days after.
After you testified?
Yes.
And so how long were you out with the dog that first time?
Like minutes.
A few minutes?
1 minute or maybe less. Just very, very, very short time.
And then you came back to the apartment building?
Yes.
Then what happened?
We took the dog inside of our apartment.
You and your wife did?
Yes. And we were going to sleep and dog was acting so nervous, running around, scratching the door. And we didn't feel so comfortable sleeping with such a big dog in our apartment. And we decided to take the dog for a walk. So we took it.
So you took it out for a walk?
Yes.
For what purpose?
Well, we thought that we can find the owner or owners and we would like to see if the dog wants to go somewhere. So
were you trying to let the dog lead you?
Yes.
When you first saw the dog in the courtyard, did you happen to notice its paws or its legs?
Not in that time, but I noticed when we got inside of the apartment.
Okay. When you took the dog inside your apartment, you and your wife, did you notice the dog's paws and legs?
Yes, I did.
And what did you notice about them?
It was bloody. There was spots.
I'm sorry?
There was spots.
Spots?
On the paws and the legs.
Of what?
Of blood.
Did it appear to be dry?
Yes.
Did you see those spots of blood on all four paws and legs?
Yes.
So you took the dog out for a walk?
Yes.
And did you have an idea in mind as to where you would take the dog?
Steven said...
Staying. Why don't you ask another question?
Did you... You had a conversation with Steven, right?
Correct.
And he told you where he'd found the dog?
Correct.
So did you decide to take the dog back to that location?
Yes.
And what was that location you took? You decided to take the dog back to?
Bundy and Dorothy.
And did you take the dog... So can you... on this chart, People's 26, can you... Please show us the route you took with the dog.
Is that from here? Cross the street in this point. Continue from here. And dog pull me to this side of street. And then we continued to here.
I think perhaps the court would like to kill the feed at this point. Thank you. All right, so you took the dog walking southbound on Bundy?
Correct.
Now, can you tell us how the dog was behaving as you proceeded south on Bundy?
It was getting more nervous and it was pulling me harder.
As you proceeded south on Bundy, the dog was pulling harder?
Yes.
In the direction of south on Bundy?
Correct.
And approximately what time was it?
It was just before midnight, like 2 minutes before midnight.
So as the dog was leading you southbound on Bundy, was it pulling harder as it got more and more south?
Sustained.
Can you tell us, when did the dog start to pull harder as you were going south on Bundy?
Around this point, he wanted to cross the street and then pull me harder. We crossed the street together and my wife followed us. And then he started pulling a lot harder to this direction.
The record, the witness is pointing to the location of Gorham and Bundy when he said that the dog started pulling a lot harder. And were you on the east side of the street?
I was on the east side of the street before we crossed.
And you crossed because the dog pulled you across?
Correct.
And then you were on the west side of the street?
Yes.
With the dog still pulling hard, pulling you southbound on Bundy?
Correct.
And on the west side?
Yes.
At some point did the dog stop?
Yes.
At what point did the dog stop?
Do you want me to show it or?
Yes.
It was just around here.
For the record, the witness has pointed to the location of 875 South Bundy, Nicole Brown icon, the red house. And when the dog stopped at that location, what did it do?
Well, dog just was in front of me and then looking at the right side of the street, so I couldn't go any further and I stopped and looked exactly the same point where the dog was looking.
Okay. So the dog turned its head to the right?
Correct.
And looked, was it looking toward the house that was at the end of the pathway?
Yes.
And because of that, you looked in the same direction?
Yes.
Can you tell us what you saw?
I saw a lady laying down, full of blood.
Not to take any photographs of the presentation screens.
All right, Mr. Boztepe, if you will look at the monitor to your right, can you tell us, sir, if that is if that depicts what you saw on the night of June the 12th, 1994, at approximately midnight, when the Akita stopped
Correct.
At 875 yes. South Bundy?
Yes.
And is that the condition in which you saw the woman?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, that location, is it very dark?
Yes, it was very dark.
As you approached the location of 875 South Bundy, were you able to see that anything was unusual? Did anything unusual appear to you before the dog stopped?
Not really.
Had the dog not stopped, would you have looked up that pathway or seen anything?
Sustained.
Was it the reason you stopped because the dog stopped and looked up the pathway?
Yes.
Otherwise, you would not have done so.
Overruled.
I wouldn't stop and look.
Now, after you saw that sight, sir, what did you do?
I turned to my wife and said that was a dead person there.
Overruled.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I turned to my wife and said that there was a dead person there, and we tried to call 911. We decided to call 911.
And what did you do to try and call 911?
We crossed the street, ran to a house, knocked the door, rang the bell, and there was nobody there. There was no answer. And then we decided to go to the next house, which is, I believe, it's the north side of the house. And when we were going there, we have seen a lady. We stopped her and then said that there was a person laying down there and she should call 911. And she said, okay, she will do that. And she just left by her car. And then I didn't trust her that she would call, and then we went to the other house, and we made a man, kind of old man, call 911.
Okay, before you went to the old man, did you knock on someone else's door?
Yes, as I said, the first time I went and knocked somebody's door.
And was that across the street from 875 South Bundy?
Yes, just opposite side of the street.
Okay, and did you ring the bell?
Yes.
Many times?
Probably a couple of times.
Did anyone answer?
No.
Was that directly across the street from 875 South Bundy?
Yes.
And no one answered the door there?
No one answered.
And then you went to the house next door to that?
Correct.
And after you spoke to that old man, what did you do?
We wait for the police arrive.
And did you still have the Akita with you?
Yes.
When the police arrived, did you meet with them?
Yes.
And did you tell them what you had seen?
Yes.
Were you able to see the body of the woman clearly from your position at the sidewalk?
Which sidewalk?
When you first stopped at 875 South Bundy and you looked up the walkway and you saw the body of the woman, were you able to see it clearly?
Yes.
Was it dark in that area?
It was dark.
So were you able to see any details, or was it just that you could see a body there?
Sustained.
How much were you able to see in the darkness when you looked up the walkway and saw the body of the woman?
I could see the person was a lady. She was blonde. I could see her arm, and that's about it.
And that was about it. Were you able to see whether there were any other victims lying there?
No.
Were you able to see all of the blood that was lying around her?
That was a lot of blood, so that's what I've seen.
You just saw a lot of blood?
Correct.
Were you able to see the paw prints in the walkway, the bloody paw prints?
No.
Well, he said no. The answer was no. And question and answer will stand.
Did you walk up that walkway?
No.
Did your wife walk up that walkway?
No.
Did anyone go up that walkway before the police arrived?
No.
Now, when the dog was with you, was it barking?
No.
I don't know if we marked the photograph, Your Honor, but perhaps we should.
Last photograph that was shown, that would be 42 equals 42.
42, thank you. All right, you spoke to the officer, the first officer that arrived at the scene?
Yes, I did.
And how long after you saw the body of the woman and you went to knock on the door and ring the doorbell of the person who didn't answer, did they arrive?
Well, it took 5 minutes after I saw the body, probably like 5 minutes for six, something like that.
For the officer to arrive?
Yes.
So about 5 minutes, 5 or 6 minutes after you saw the body?
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Cochran.
Good afternoon, Mr. Boztepe. From the time that you left your residence on Montana to start this trek back to 875 Bundy, did the dog that you've been describing for us, did that dog bark at all during that time frame?
No.
And the dog had appeared calm as he was in this courtyard area and in your apartment before that, at least until you put him inside your house?
Correct.
You had arrived back home in Montana at what time that evening?
I arrived around 11:40.
About 11:40 p.m.?
Yes, I arrived to home 11:40 p.m.
And when you first came home, this is Sunday evening at about 11:40, June 12th, right?
Correct.
When you first came home, did you immediately talk with and see Mr. Stephen Schwab?
Yes.
And did you see the dog almost immediately also?
Yes.
So that would be right around 11:40 or shortly thereafter, is that correct?
Yes.
This is before you went inside your apartment, sir?
Yes.
All right. And after a conversation with Mr. Schwab and perhaps his wife, it was then decided that you would try to keep the dog in your apartment for that particular night, is that correct?
Correct.
And you've described for us how that didn't work out because the dog seemed agitated and was scratching and wanted to get outside, right?
Right.
All right. So what time was it that you left your Montana address to start heading back south toward 875 Bundy?
Just before midnight.
Right before midnight?
And just before midnight.
Just before midnight. So when you say just before midnight, place it for me. 5 minutes before midnight? 10 minutes before midnight?
3, 4 minutes, 2 minutes.
A very short period of time.
Very.
All right. And then you've described for us how you, the dog pulled you along the street and you ended up at 875 South Bundy, right?
Right.
All right. And the photograph, without putting that photograph back up there, when you stopped and your attention was turned to your right up this walkway, you saw a lot of blood, for one thing. Is that correct?
Correct.
And you saw a gate that was open. Is that correct?
I didn't see the gate.
You didn't see the gate, but you saw the body of a woman. Is that correct?
Correct.
Attired in a black dress, right?
Right.
It appeared to be blonde?
Yes.
And there was nothing blocking your view. In other words, you could look right up the walkway and see this particular body there, right?
Yes.
And you, in looking at that photograph, did you notice that the gate was open, was wide open?
Well, I didn't see the gate.
All right. And if you saw the photograph, would that refresh your recollection at all?
I still didn't see the gate.
You didn't see the gate at all that night? You just saw an open space. Would that be a fair statement?
Yes.
And then you saw the body below the open space?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Correct.
All right. And at the time you made these observations, were you by yourself or with your wife at that point?
First I saw the body and then I told her, so she saw it too.
And was she standing right alongside of you, sir?
She was a little bit behind of me.
All right, so then she moved up to where you were so she could then look and see?
Well, she didn't get a clear view because I was almost blocking the view. She just was behind of me, and she just looked at it.
All right. So as I understand it, you saw, you made these observations.
Correct.
You said something to your wife. She got a kind of a glancing view of what was taking place. Is that right?
Right.
And you saw enough that you wanted to then go make this 911 call?
Correct.
To get some help. Is that correct?
Correct.
All right. Now, from a standpoint of perspectives, how good are you at distances?
I don't know.
Okay. Well, let's see how good you are. With regard to, let's assume that you are out of the street, out of the sidewalk, in front of 875. How far was this body from where you were, if you're assuming that in the witness box you were at that location? Can you point to something about where I am or somewhere in this courtroom?
You should get a little bit closer to
me. Okay, you stop me when I should be. And I'll
all right.
Do that, okay, sir?
That's okay.
Right here? All right. Your Honor, we can estimate or you can tell us.
About 10 or 12 feet.
All right. About 10 or 12 feet. Looking straight on, is that right?
Right.
And that would be from the sidewalk on the western side of Bundy to where you made these observations. Is that correct?
Correct.
And neither you nor your wife or the animal approached where you saw this body. Is that correct?
Correct.
You then left the area, and that's when you went and made the calls to the police. Is that correct?
Correct.
And did I understand you to say the police arrived in a very short period of time after that?
Yes.
Would I be correct in assuming the police arrived there about 12:13?
12:13.
About 12:13 a.m.
I didn't have a watch, so.
You weren't wearing a watch. They came, how the police officer came a fairly short time after you call?
Correct.
How many minutes was that?
After I made the old man call the police, probably it took 2 or 3 minutes.
All right. Now, before you asked the elderly gentleman to call the police, you'd gone to another house and rang the bell.
Correct.
And then and nobody responded there, right?
Correct.
So do you know what time it would have been, your best approximation, what time it would have been that the police would have been called?
I can't make any.
All right. But they came within a short period of time after that.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Correct.
All right. And then you then had occasion to talk with this police officer when he arrived. Is that correct?
Correct.
After the police arrived, you were present, were you not, when a man who lived across the street from 875 Bundy came out and made a statement to the police? You recall that?
No.
You don't recall a man coming out and making a statement about the time that the dog started barking that night?
No.
Did you at some point on June 13th, 1994, at about 4:25 in the morning, have occasion to speak with an officer by the name of Roberts, R-O-B-E-R-T-S.
I don't know the name.
All right, but did a police officer come and talk to you at your Montana address?
A police officer, well, I was in the police station, so detective come and talked to me in that point.
All right, did you talk to the police at the police station?
Correct, I did.
And how late did you stay at the police station that morning?
Can you repeat?
How late did you stay at the police station that morning?
I believe it was around 4:30 or 5.
And that was West Los Angeles Police Station?
Yes.
The West Los Angeles Division? While you were there, did you give a statement to a police officer by the name of Roberts?
I don't know the name, but I gave a statement.
All right. And in that statement, you tried to be as accurate as you could. Is that correct?
I didn't understand what you said.
In that statement to the police officer, you tried to be as accurate as you could?
Correct.
You told the police about this woman by her car that you asked to call 911, did you not?
Yes.
You tell the police that after the police arrived, a man that lives across the street from 875 came out and said the neighborhood dog started barking at 10:30 p.m. Did you tell him that?
Yes, I remember, yeah.
You remember making that statement to the police while you were at West Los Angeles Station?
Yes.
Which man was that who made that statement?
It was the old man who called 911, I guess.
The same old man, the elderly gentleman who called him?
Correct.
Who made this call?
Correct.
And do you know his name?
No.
And you were present when he made that statement to the police officer, right?
Yes.
Now, at any time were you ever present on or about June 17th, 1994? Let's strike that. Were you ever present on June 13th, 1994, after you went back home to Montana? And did the police come to your house after you'd been at the police station at all and talked to anyone?
Well, they gave a ride back to us, and they didn't come to our house.
All right. They gave you a ride back home?
Correct.
And when you got back home with the police, do you recall whether or not they talked to you, Mr. Boztepe, and also to Mr. Stephen Schwab?
They didn't talk to me. They talked to Mr. Schwab.
They talked to Mr. Schwab. And were you present during the time you saw them talking to him?
Yes.
And would that have been about 5:30 in the morning?
Possible, yeah.
And did you hear the officer, the same officer, Roberts, was the same officer who had talked to you at West Los Angeles Station?
Correct.
Talked to him, right?
Correct.
And you overheard the conversation, right? A part of it?
Part of it.
And did you hear Mr. Schwab tell the officer that he had been walking his dog in the area around Bundy and Dorothy?
Yes.
Did you hear him say that this dog, meaning the Akita, had come up to him and started following him and his dog?
Yes.
Tell that? And that it was obviously lost, running from house to house, that is, the Akita had been lost?
Right. As I heard, yes.
Right. And that it kept following me till I got home? Words to that effect?
Yes.
And that Mr. Schwab told Officer Roberts that when I first saw it, the Akita, it was around 11:15 p.m.
Yes, with the court reporter. All right, thank you, counsel. Mr. Cochran, would you conclude your cross-examination, please?
Sure, Your Honor. May I proceed?
Yes.
Now, Mr. Boztepe, did you hear Mr. Schwab say to Officer Roberts that when I first saw it, meaning the Akita, it was around 11:15 p.m.?
I don't remember.
Did you hear Mr. Schwab give the officer a time that he first saw the dog that night?
I guess so.
All right.
I'm not so sure.
All right, you're not sure of the time. You heard him give a time, you believe?
I'm not so sure about his giving the time.
All right. You don't have a recollection of that?
No.
All right. Did you see the police officer who was talking to Mr. Schwab write down notes about what Mr. Schwab was saying?
Was writing something.
He was writing down? And he was writing down notes similar to the way he had written down notes with you at the station. Is that a fair statement?
Oh,
ask
him.
You saw it.
Looked like.
Looked like?
Looked like.
What does that mean?
It means that you asked him, was it similar?
Okay.
And he said, yeah, it looked like it.
Just give him the elaborate order. It looked like, meaning looked like the same thing. Is that right, sir?
I didn't see what he wrote when I was talking to him, so.
I understand.
It looked like a paper and pen. So.
But he had a notepad or whatever.
Correct.
Is that right?
Thank you, and I have nothing further, so thank you.
Ms. Clark, any redirect from Mr. Boztepe?
Sir, did Mr. Schwab tell you what time it was when he first left his apartment to walk his dog that night?
I don't remember.
Do you recall him telling you about what time it was when he found the Akita at Bundy and Dorothy?
I don't remember.
You don't remember anything he told you about that night?
Well, he told something, but I don't remember anything about the time.
You don't remember what he told you about the times?
I don't.
But he did tell you about having found the dog at Dorothy and Bundy?
Correct.
And that was at some point earlier, before you saw him that night?
Sure.
And do you, when he was speaking to the police officer, tell him about the same thing that he was telling you? About where he found the dog?
I was concentrating on the action, not the time, so I don't know.
At the time that the police officer was there?
Yes.
Were you paying attention to what he was telling the police officer?
Not really.
Okay. So were you paying attention to what times he was saying to the police officer that night?
No.
And do you remember, do you have no specific recollection of the times that he told you?
No.
They brought you and your wife back home, is that correct?
Correct.
And the police officer was being, was he conducting these interviews in a rather friendly manner? He wasn't being hostile or anything, was he?
He was pretty friendly.
He was pretty friendly?
Sure.
And when you observed Mr. Schwab talking to the police officer, it was pretty much a conversation like you and I are having. The officer would ask questions, and Mr. Schwab would respond to the questions?
Correct.
Mr. Schwab didn't seem to be angry or anything, did he, at that point?
No.
Seemed to be like normal to you at that point?
It was, he was sleepy. He was just talking.
Okay, other than being sleepy, he seemed to be normal?
As normal as you can be. So.
All right, as normal as one could be?
As normal as you can be at 5 o'clock. So.
You could understand he'd been sleeping, but you could understand what he was saying when he responded to the officer's question, isn't that correct?
Can you repeat it, please?
Yes. We understand that it was 5:30 or so in the morning. But you could understand Mr. Schwab's responses to the officer's questions, couldn't you? The part you listened to?
Well, he was responding, but I wasn't listening.
All right, but he was responding to what the officer asked him. Is that what?
That's speculation.
Overruled.
Can you answer that?
Yes, he was responding.
All right, thank you very much, sir. I have nothing further, Your Honor.
It's only 11 questions. Okay. Ms. Clark, anything more for Mr. Boztepe?
Mr. Boztepe, did you indicate that you were present when a man came from across the street and talked about when he heard dogs barking?
Man didn't cross the street, but the man was living across the street of the location. He came and talked to the police.
Okay. Were you present when he did that?
Yes.
And did you recall what he said to the police?
I remember this, but nothing else.
And what is it you remember?
He was saying around 10:30, all the neighborhood dogs was barking pretty abnormally, something like that.
He was saying around 10:30, the neighborhood dogs were barking.
I'm trying.
Your Honor, I'm just trying to make sure that I understood his testimony.
Counsel, listen.
I'm trying. Mr. Boztepe, could you please tell us what you heard the man say?
Yeah,
he was asking
you. Around 10:30, all the neighborhood dog was barking.
That's what you recall hearing him say?
Yes.
And then you told that to another police officer?
I don't remember.
Let me show you your statement, sir. show you the line here. Second paragraph, the last one, sir. After the police arrived, the man that lives across from the house came out and said the neighborhood dog started barking at 10:30 p.m. Do you recall saying that to the police?
Well, probably I said it, but I don't remember.
You don't remember it this time?
No.
Okay. And is it your recollection that the man said around 10:30?
Yes.
Anything more?
No, that's it.
Thank you. Mr. Cochran? All right. Mr. Boztepe, thank you very much for coming in this afternoon. Please don't discuss your testimony with anybody else except the lawyers on the case until the matter is concluded. Thank you very much, sir. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a brief recess for the court reporter, 15 minutes. Please remember my admonition to you. Don't discuss the case amongst yourselves, form any opinions about the case, allow anybody to talk to you about the case, or perform any deliberations. Ladies and gentlemen, the audience, we're still in session. If you'll be quiet, please. All right, if you step into the jury room, please. About the burglars.
That's right.
Got it. Okay.
I really, if I may, Your Honor, ask for the court's indulgence. She's 85 years old, and I'd like to be able to let her testify and go home today.
Well, we're only taking 15 minutes, but I need to share with you a problem. So, why don't you approach? Record in the Simpson matter, all the parties are again present. All right, let's have the jury, please.
People call Miss Elsie Tistert.